So my name is Thibaut Cornet. As Laetitia said, I'm the head of sales of the Biomonte Group. I've been working in sales position, sales director for France, in charge of some foreign countries for a while. Key account manager for European key accounts, and at the end, in charge of sales for footwear and textile at Salomon. I had a short 4 or 5 years break into the sales world at the very beginning of the apparel business at Salomon, where I was in charge to create the business unit when Salomon decided to go into apparel, and I think this was in 2001. And 20 years after, they just closed the business unit last week. That's another story. I left Salomon after 18 years. I joined the Millemontaine Group, at that time, Groupe Lafumeur, when they bought a brand called Eder. And I was asked or proposed, I decided to go there to be the general manager for Eder. That brand has just been sold 2 years ago. It's not anymore in our perimeter. In between, my job has changed. And I am in the position, which I'm still today, which is in charge of sales for both brands. So we're talking about two brands, Millet and Lafumeur, for all countries. We distribute also after in several countries around the world and for all channels of distribution. So not only wholesale, but also retail and also e-commerce. And that is the topic of the day. We're going to talk multi-channel distribution. I'm going to try to explain you what it means for us, especially what it means for a company like us to drive two different distribution channels. Well, at least more than two, we'll see that later. And the angle I choose for that conference, I don't know how you say that, is to try to explain you what it means internally. Externally, it's easy. I mean, you know what a store is, you know what it means, you know what a website is. But what I thought could be interesting for you to understand is what people never see or don't see, except if you're in the company. So the part below water, which is what are all the consequences within a company the day you decide to go multi-channel, which you don't realize the day you decide to do that, but you realize later, and you have to deal with that. So that is how it will be. Before that, it's not to make advertising for our brands, but I thought it would be interesting to give you a little bit of background of who we are. Short summary. So the Millemontaine Group, this is two brands, this I have said. You have some macro numbers. We do half of our business in France and half outside of France. Interesting to say that our second market, this is not Germany or Italy or Spain, this is Japan, where we do almost 20% of our turnover. The split per season in value, this is roughly 40% summer, 60% winter. Actually, we sell more product in summer, but their unit value is less. So that's why in value this is like that. So, but pretty much balanced for an outdoor brand. We do today 70% B2B. B2B is clear for everybody what it means. So we sell to dealers, they do resell to consumers. 30% B2C, we sell direct to consumers through different channels. We are a small or mid-sized company, 640 people around the world, 230 in France, 60% outside of France. What makes us so many people, you might thought we would be less, is that we are running two production facilities, which is not common in our industry. Most of our competitors, they don't have their own production. We do. We have two factories, one in Hungary, making all of our high-end products. So everything, Gore-Tex product, free layer jackets, I mean, everything 300 euro and above. And another one in Tunisia. This is not exactly Europe, although it is from a custom point of view, where we do lightwear, fleeces, pants, I mean, less technical parts. In terms of gender, 35% men, 65% women, which we are proud of. Distribution, talking B2B, about 3,000 customers around the world, dealing in more than 40 countries, selling more than 2.5 million products per year. Roughly gives you an idea of who we are and our size. Once again, in that industry, for those who know it a little bit, we are a mid-sized company. I mean, there are giants 20, 30, 40 times bigger than us. And there are also a lot of brands which are smaller than us. I'm not going to speak about both brands. I've decided to focus on one, which is the biggest of two, which is Miele, which is the most famous one, and which is the one which is the most advanced when we talk multi-channel distribution. So starting from now on, I'm going to be talking about Miele. Everything I'm going to say is more or less true for La Fuma too, but less advanced. Few words to remind you who we are. We are a French company born here, in Annecy, 100 years ago, exactly. Unique know-how in making performance, mountaineering, apparel, footwear, and equipment since 1921. Actually, we're not doing that since 1921, because during 50 years, we've been doing, I don't know how you call that. You know that stuff that you use when you go to the market to carry your vegetables and fruits. So the real outdoor business started in the 50s. Tell me if it's too loud.
Is it better now? Less.
Speak. Basically, our product offer is split in two main categories or segments, which we identify through two different logos. I don't know if it's very clever to have two logos, but this is how we are today. The upper part, the left part, Mountain Expert, that part with the trilogy logo, the historical blue, white, and red logo. This is the premium part. This is about mountaineering. This is about high-end product. Let's say the most advanced, the most core part of our business. And the rest of it, mountain sport, which is everything else, which is about most of the outdoor sport you may practice in the mountain and in the outdoors. We do all that. We do apparel, of course. This is approximately 70% or close to 70% of our business, which is, for your information, other proportional to the average of the industry. The average of the industry is the apparel market is 50% of the worldwide market. We do 70. So we might say we're super strong in apparel. The truth is we are not strong enough in the other category, and especially footwear, because we do only 15% of our sales in footwear, while the market is 30. So our market share in footwear in other world, is half of what it should be, and this is a point of focus for us. Backpack and equipment, 20% of our sales, this is pretty good. Those category, backpack and sleeping bag, represent less than that of the outdoor market, average in Europe. So we're doing a good job there, and here we need to improve. That is it about the brand, except you have additional questions that you really want to understand something about BA, but the topic is not to speak about BA, the topic is to speak about multi-channel distribution. So, but just before going into the heart of the topic, I'm gonna show you a little video which explain you more who we are and what we do. And after that, we'll jump into the real topic. And this is where techniques or not. Since the dawn of time, man has had an insatiable desire to conquer nature. But the end, some patient for 100 years, working hand in hand with his story's greatest adventurers. I've seen the birth of the backpack and innovating and powerful.
Bonjour. My apologies for this mess. Let's start over, shall we? Allow me to introduce myself. My name is Michel. I'm an old friend of the Mie family, and I work here at the Mie offices. There's a big deal around here. From grocery bags to backpacks with cutting-edge innovations to the greatest mountaineers of climbing history, Mie has made a habit of gearing up pros and amateurs alike. And breaking records while we're at it. You seem like a smart young lad. Go ask the workshop if the new Everest prototype will be ready. If my calculations are correct, Maurice Herzog and Louis Lachenal should be reaching the summit right about now. Were they wearing the Annapurna 50s like we tested? It's enough. At me offices, it's always go, 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 isn't it? Oh, merci, Huguette. Louis and Maurice just hit the Annapurna first 8,000 meters, mission accompli. But where is the champagne? Oh. Sacré Louis. I need to tell the guys about this.
Bonati, le meilleur. René de Maison.
Bonatti,
je te dis. De Maison.
Bonatti.
De Maison.
Take a look at this. Professional mountain guides in their natural habitat. Let's see what they're saying.
La mort, le meilleur alpiniste, c'est René de Maison. Il n'y a personne qui lui arrive à la cheville.
Vive la France. Non, non, non. Le meilleur, c'est Bonatti, votre miséria. René de Maison, il n'est rien. Vous devez Bonatti.
Ok. Signor, please. At the end of the day, we're all here for the same reason. The love of mountaineering. There are no winners or losers. Actually, they were all wearing Mie backpacks for the summits, so technically, Mie wins. They were the real pioneers. The rest of us are just following in their footsteps, no?
Une immense paroi d'épaisseur surplombante de 800 mètres de haut. Partageant la inquiétude, un hélicoptère participe aux recherches.
Our products are tested under extreme conditions at altitudes of up to 8,000 meters. Through wind, rain, and snow. And they're tested on real climbers like Legend Reinhold Messner, the first alpinist to climb Everest without oxygen. They're testing on you, and they're testing on me. Then it was the 70s. It was all about free love and living, breathing with nature. So Mie launched their first climbing range. All free connections. I mean, it was a lifestyle choice for free spirited hippies. Let's go ahead.
Coping by breathing with nature.
Don't worry, guys, I'm fine. Thanks God for all this recycled water. Over the years, Mie has recycled more than 1.5 million meters of rope. Because out there, guys, your rope is your lifeline. After a couple of decades in business, our office grew and we added a few more people to the team. Oh my days. This jacket used to be the jacket. Oh, words for our first. The backpack, the Everest expedition boots, the Gore-Tex alpine jacket, and the matrix shoes. Some were less successful. Misha, she would. Johnny, that pen didn't work. What? I haven't seen this one before. Je l'avais mort.
C'est du beau travail, les amis.
Old.
That has been there since end of last year. So we're back into a kind of a family business. So now I'm going to tell you another story, which is about our distribution, where we come from and where we've been. So as the story always starts, like once upon a time, business was simple and easy. And it was like during 80 to 90 years. That was simple and easy because we were a mono-channel company, like most of our competitors. We were selling to sporting good retailers. So you have some names on the screens. And that was simple in a sense that that was our only way to distribute our product. Sell to dealers, we resell to consumers. And during many, many years, it was like that. Brands do sell product to retailers, retailers sell product to consumers. The first one to change the game actually were the retailers. The day they decided that they could do product by themselves and they created their private label. We have one of the most famous in the world, the biggest one, Decathlon. But before that, because Decathlon, I think, was created in 76, and at the beginning they had no brands. The rules were simple: brands do product, dealers distribute product, a simple flow, a simple organization. And several types of distribution in terms of size, more or less specialists. Here you have multi-sport generalists like Intersport, and you have specialists like Ojo Camber, to take French example. But it was only that. Then came those guys later. Let's say this started like 10 years ago. Before for Amazon, of course, but for us, this became a topic about 10 years ago. So you know them, I'm sure you know some of them. You are consumers of those. This is still about B2B. This is still about selling product to someone else that will resell it to consumers. So with most of those guys, our business model is still B2B. It is about to change. Actually, it has changed. We're not anymore in B2B with Zalando, for instance. But this is very different type of animals. But this is the same business model. It creates some changes within your organization, but not a lot. And this is not that difficult to handle. Different skills, you need different types of people to deal with those, but it does not create a revolution actually within your company. We did not change totally the company because those guys appear. That's a different type of people. So we had to deal with those. And then we did that. We had a website since a long time, but that website was not selling any product. But under the pressure of especially other websites selling our product, one day or the other, you tell yourself, I'm going to do it by myself. So from a media, the website becomes a shop. That is here, it is. Yes.
When did it become an e-commerce shop?
I think it was 2015, 16, something like that, that we turned it into a store. Actually, the truth is we were reluctant. Because when you have a B2B culture, you think this is not your job to do that. You think you're going to become the main competitors of your own customers, which is the traditional schizophrenia or paranoia. This is what everybody thinks. So we hesitated for a while because we are an old company rooted in B2B. Young brands, new brands, this is not even a topic, not even a question. And digital native brands, per definition, they choose that first. But that was not our case. So once again, I'm talking about my experience at BA. For us, that was years of let's go, maybe not, maybe we should, what's going to happen, and so on and so on. When you do that, then you enter a brand new world. That's for sure. A totally brand new world. And approximately at the same time, we also decided to do that. For the same reason. Your customers are doing your job. They buy less product from you. They create their own private label. One day or the other, you think, I'm going to sell my product by myself. And then you open your first store. And when you do that, you don't really realize what it means. And it should be easy. Let's find a place. Let's put product in the product we already have. Nobody to challenge us on the product. I mean, no buyer in front of you. Which is going to tell you this is too expensive. This is too small. That's your product. You decide what you put in the stores. It looks easy. I promise you it's easy only on the paper. This is super complex. This is really challenging. Not only because we are not a native retailer, but because this is complex. We'll see later on some part of those complexity, but this is, I think I would say this is the toughest part of our business, running a physical network of stores for many reasons. More difficult than the web. You don't become successful overnight. When you have done the web and you have done the stores, you do that. It's not a store, it's an outlet. So I'm sure you've been already. This is where you buy product from previous years at a lower price. Once you go B2C, you create stock. You need to clean that stock. You need outlets. That's a logical consequence. I know almost no brands with a B2C network, whether on the web or physical, that don't have that. The most famous one, the biggest one, the first one to do it, we are the first one to go into retail. Their names are Nike, Adidas. They do billions in outlets. We do billions in outlets. It's mandatory. When you deal B2B only, you don't have that issue. You sold your product. We'll see later on how. This is not anymore your issue. I mean, this is your issue that you're after, but you've sold your product, they belong to somebody else, they've been paid to you, whether they sell or they don't sell, this is not immediately your problem. When it is your store at the end of the season, now, end of spring summer season, your store is 150 square meter. You need to take spring summer unsold product out. You need to bring fall winter new collection in. What do? With your spring summer product? You sell them here in outlets. So we also had to create our outlet networks. And this is a place where everybody, you need that to get rid of leftover inventory, as I said. But this is also a place where people go. If you follow the consumers and if you look at this behavior, we are all consumers of all those channels. We all buy in multi stores, multi brand stores, we all buy in brand stores, we all buy on the web, we all buy in outlets. Someone says you never bought in an outlet at the time. Yes.
So do you think that in your outlet you only sell overstock or do you have other products
in your outlet? No, we sell previous season inventory. Official answer. Truth. We sell all season inventory, which we have other produce on purpose. Not that, and this is something which you need to monitor carefully. You don't want that to become your primary business. We've set the bar in terms of square meter, in terms of numbers of outlet, in terms of number of pieces. And we don't want to go above that. The size of our outlet network is a direct consequence, mathematical, of our inventory position at the end of each season. As a result of that, this year we've been closing 3 outlets in Europe because we don't need them anymore because the market is nowadays without stock, lacking of stock. So there's no reason to create that business. 3 years ago, or yeah, end of 19, something like that, a lot of inventory in the market. You don't know what you're going to do, what to do with it. Sorry. You need more square meter to clean those products. In the way to clean leftover inventory, this is the best way. The other way is what used to be all those discounters, which you never know what they do with your product. At least here, we are at home. Some of those factory outlet centers, they look very good. So the impact on your brand image is not that bad, I would say. You don't destroy your brand. And the average level of factory outlet center is going up and up and up. There's one in the nearest from here, it's probably Ville Fontaine, nearby Lyon. I mean, it's a cool place. I mean, for people who love shopping, but yeah, that store is great. The Nike store is great. Our store is not that bad. Some competitors around also have store there. I mean, the retail environment is it's not really hurting your brand image. And once again, there are consumers, they cannot buy our product full price. At least they can have access to our product with 30% discount. That is the rule on outlet. This is from previous season. We have in Lyon downtown on the festive, the branded store. We have an outlet in Ville Fontaine. Since we have both are working better. There is no cannibalism. Because the product downtown are not the product outside. And consumers, final our brands, I mean, they know they want the latest product, the new colors, the new season product. This is downtown. They want a good price of the deal. This is in the outlet. So when you have done that, and you put everything on the same screen, you discover the type of mess you are in. To drive those different channels, that is pretty complex. And this is what I'm going to try to explain you, especially considering that this is not the only channel we have. But to keep it simple, I skipped two things, which are, let's say, a hybrid version of the existing one. The marketplaces. So in our marketplaces, we sell, but through the marketplace. So Zalando, typically. If you go on Zalando and you want to buy our product, you will see that the vendor is us. So Zalando don't do anything anymore. We push the product, so we decide what we push. We decide the price. And when you buy the product, you pay Zalando. Zalando gives us back the money minus their commission. So this is somewhere in between dealing with a pure player and doing e-commerce by yourself. That's what I call it, hybrid business model. The other one of hybrid business model is franchise or commission affiliation, and there's several words, vendor management, location. This is all about the same. Basically, this is a media store. It looks like a media store, it tastes like a media store, but the store don't belong to us. It is run by somebody else. For those, for the locals, for who lives there, or people who've been to Chamonix, we had a media store in Chamonix during 10 years. That was not our store. And most of the store in Ripacar in Chamonix, if you've been there, the Salomon store does not belong to Salomon. The Arteryx store does not belong to Arteryx. The Columbia store does not belong to Columbia. The Norse store does not belong to Norse. They are all run by partners. We've been in that situation for 10 years. The new Chamonix store, the new store, which is 100 meters away from the previous one, belongs to us. We decided that we wanted to run a business by ourselves. So this is our stores, our employees, we pay the rent, blah, blah. But from a consumer point of view, this is also a way to have stores, and we'll see why people want to have stores later on, without being the owner of that store. And most of our competitors, they also act like that. They have their own stores, but we'll see later on that it costs a lot of money. And they have stores which are run by others. Whether this is classical wholesale, they buy their product to resell and they pay the supplier, or whether it is commission, so actually we cash in the retail value without VAT and we pay them the commission. I mean, there is all those subtlety. I don't know if it's the way to say that, but all that comes on top of that. So this is not exactly that, but it is not so far away. So so that gives you a little bit our perimeter. We
yes, at the same time, when you put the whole collection in the outlet, you also sold it to some people like VP or Curious Pro Shop.
Yes, VP is a discounter.
Yep.
We used to work with them as we used to work with discounter. We stopped that 2 years ago, and now we handle them as a marketplace.
Okay.
So they don't buy any product from us anymore. We are the ones selling on VP. If you buy one of our products on VP, actually, you buy it from us. We better master the offer. We better master the promotion period, and we better master the price.
And then for culture.
And private, they have two activities, actually. They have private sports shop, the discounter, if I may call them like that. And there is private sports shop, Le Shop, where they buy a full price product from us and they resell it. So normal business model. It's after that, it's a distribution strategy to decide the weighted value you want to give to each part of your business. Some brands use private sports shop only as a discounter. Some use it only as a shop. Some do both. We do both, and we do both on the one third, two third, I would say. One third clearance, two third full price. and this change of COVID season, those guys today are in trouble because there's no inventory in the market. VP is doing fine when there's a lot of inventory and everybody needs to clear their stuff before your end. Since COVID, the market has been cleaned of product. And on top of that, there is the issue of supply those days. I don't know if you're aware, but if you want to buy a pair of Nike, do it now, because by Christmas, there won't be any shoes anymore anywhere. this comes on top, and it's going to last for a few seasons. So now we are in that mess. We have all that to handle, and I'm going to try to show you what it means in the company. We're going to look at it from the impact on the culture of the company, because I think this is the main impact. What does it mean in the sales department, so my department? What does it mean in the marketing and communication department, and so on? What about the product development, because this has also an impact on your product development? What about production and supply chain? Easy to understand that this has an impact, but also in finance and controlling, and also in human resources, and also for IT. So when you go multi-channel, this changes your organization all across the company. Things that you may don't think about from the outside. Before I explain you what it's changed, this I should have said at the beginning. We are not yet an omni-channel company, we're just a multi-channel company. I make a difference between, which is we deal with different channels. We are not really yet able to manage them and to have them communicating and working together. We are at the beginning of the click to store or web to store or ship to web or store to web or click and collect and so on and so on. Other warning, so we are, what I mean is we are in the middle of the process. We are not a company in multi-channel since 20 years where everything is running. Second thing, what I'm going to tell you and what I'm telling you since the beginning, this is not the truth, this is our truth. This is not a theory. As your student, I think it's important to understand that this is a practical example. And this is not a business model as something which should be a copy and test because successful. I prefer to stay humble on that one. What I want to do is just to give you some insight, food for thought, and hopefully at the end, maybe some question and answers. So let's go into it. Before that, maybe a question I should have answered, which is why do most of the brand now go multi-channel or omni-channel? You may have ideas on that one. Any idea why we do that? To make our life easy, to create a mess, to make it complex. Yeah, one reason is that one, come later. The first one, really, is to decrease dependency on retail and get rid of the trade pressure. Because at the last time where we were only B2B and life was simple, that was not that simple. Because every season, and especially with key account, at every important meeting, you are in front of a guy who can do that or that. And if he does that, you are in trouble. If you do X million euro with a customer and the day after he decides that he doesn't want to work with you anymore, you're in the deep shit. It happens to us. 2015, Decathlon, one of our biggest customers, the biggest sporting goods retailer in the world. New boss at the end of Decathlon, this guy decides they don't want brands at all anymore. No more brands at Decathlon, only their brands. New CEO from the family. Straightforward statement, all brands out. Oops. During 2 years, you suffer a little bit. I mean, they do it clean, they explain you, it's going to be 2 years. So next year, we cut by half, and the year after, we stop. This lasts a couple of years until the day France win the World Cup. And suddenly there is two stars on the jersey. But that jersey is a Nike jersey. And you can't buy it at Decathlon because Decathlon shoot Nike also out of their stores. That day, that's not exactly only for that, but that's what they say. They discovered maybe that was not a good idea to get rid of brands. And that maybe brands should come back. Actually, they knew it for a while because it's not only about the two-star jersey of the French team, it's also about all the product they don't have in their assortment and that people want. And for instance, at Decathlon today, you cannot buy a Gore-Tex jacket. Since 5 years, there is no Gore-Tex jacket in any Decathlon in the world. It's an 11 billion euro company. You cannot buy a Gore-Tex jacket at Decathlon because they don't have a Gore-Tex license. None of their brands carry the Gore-Tex technology and logo. Only brands like us and others have access to Gore-Tex. If they want Gore-Tex back in their world, so, but when it happens, what happened to you?
So, you realize
that you decide every 6 months, you do less from the retailers. They are waiting your total business, must be less. Second reason, usual one.
Ça marche, hein?
We do that because we think we're going to increase our margin and profit. We will see later, this is not always true. If it was so easy, there won't be any sporting goods retailers and all brands will find more product by that. Because, yes, margin is
high.
But you need to look at it at the bottom of the line. And this is not that easy. Once again, if it was true, sporting goods would disappear. So, but this is one of the reasons and one of the motivations of brands to go retail.
Ouais, très bien.
You do it also to be able to fully express your brand DNA. This is a bit technical, but this is true that when you are.
Mais du coup, c'est bon, du coup, il faut que je reste là par contre. C'est bon, tu peux revenir. Ouais, mais si, non, mais je veux dire, si je
suis là, consumer.
Ouais,
you can't really understand who Mie is except in a Mie store. And you can sell whatever you want to sell. Why, when you are B2B only, this is not true, because this is the buyer of this item. You show him 10 jackets, he buys one. Here, you have your 10 jackets, you can decide. You cannot put the 10 in your stores, stores are too small, but you can decide the 3 or the 4. You have an innovation, dealers don't believe in it, you can do it by yourself. And sometimes you have good surprises. We have product today that dealers are not buying from us because maybe your competitors has the same product at a better price or better product at the same price. So they don't buy it from us. If we don't have direct access to consumer via the web or via the store, we cannot propose that product to consumers. And sometimes we have the good surprise that that product sells. Or it's because it's so expensive that they don't want to buy from us. Example, our most expensive product is the Avalanche backpack. It's more than 1,000 euro back. Dealers are reluctant to buy that and to stop that because you won't sell that every morning. We sell most of those backpacks by ourselves. Not because we want. I would be very happy to have to sell those backpacks to more dealers, simply because this is so expensive, so exclusive, so unique. The market is so small that they don't want to buy that from us. So we do it by ourselves. But ultimately, and today this is the reason why most brands do that, we want to reach and we want to own the final consumer. This is today what is the most important for everyone, because this is the one with the power. The power does not belong to the brands. The power does not belong to the retailers. Power belongs to the consumer. You decide what you buy, when you buy, where, how you buy, what price you want to buy on the web, in the store, during the weekend. Consumers have the full power. Of course, under influences, but the final power is in the end of the consumer. So the main reason ultimately why brands want to have B2C business is to have direct access to consumer. And the name of that distribution model, D2C, direct to consumer, means what it means. So today, maybe we did not realize that at the time where we did that, but today that is the most important. And on the web, what is the most important? It is to get your data. We want your email address. That's what we want. And this gives a lot of value to a company. Company, 100 million euro turnover with no web business, and the same company with 100 million euro turnover, maybe less profitable with, but with a database of 1 million consumers, the value of that company is double. So this is the main reason why today people go B2C. This is to own the consumers, because this is the one with the power, and this is what gives the value to the company. And this is why those companies, those pure players, even knowing that most of them are loss-making operations, losing money during 25 years. What makes them so valuable is that they have, you belong to them. In other words, you belong to them, they activate you whenever they want, and basically they sell you whatever they want. So that is the main reason why we do that. So when we do that, what happened in the company? Above all, and that was my experience, it's a cultural revolution. You go from a simple organization where everything is organized to sell to sporting good dealers to a complex organization. You deal only with retailers, and suddenly you need to deal with consumers. And the type of discussion that you have with consumers has nothing to do with the type of discussion you have with retailers, of course. And you have to do both at the same time. You go from physical business that you are well aware of, and you know how it works, and this is physical, and you can touch it, to digital, and both at the same time. You used to work with a 6-month planning in front of you. I will describe after that the selling cycle. But suddenly you have a part of the company which works 6 months ahead. So we work for the coming 6 months. That is the wholesale team, the B2B organization. Your retail team, I would say their time frame, their working time frame is like 6 days of the week. Things happen every week, and so, and you may change things every week. While in wholesale, you don't change things every week because you place orders for the coming 6 months, and then if something goes wrong, you can correct it only in 6 months. And if something goes good, you will know it only in 6 months. And then the 6-hour time frame, which is the time frame on the web. And I could even say 1 hour, and I could say half an hour. Every minute, something happened on your website. And every minute you may change something on your website. And every minute there is a product less or product more, and so on, and so on, and so on. So suddenly you have a company which needs to manage all those differences. This is the same company with the same people, or approximately the same people. The whole company was everybody working at the same rhythm, everybody working with the same tools. And suddenly, multiplicity, complexity of tools, and different rhythm, and And there's the one thinking about what's going to happen this weekend because I don't know what. This is the high five, and we need to activate something on the social network. I can tell you the people in the B2B team, they don't give a shit. They are taking orders for spring summer 22. So the high five, yes, fun for them, but it's not going to impact their business. So going through the various departments, what does it mean? Sales before. Before I will sell, we have a unit team, a B2B sales rep. So like all company sales reps, so you know what a sales rep here is, he has a car, go and visit customers and he takes orders, pre-orders. In France, about 500 dealers to take care of, team of 10 reps, pretty easy. To support them, a customer service team, they deal with retailers, they know them well, always the same since years. And we have called B2B topics. Basically, you work twice per year. This is their life. You work hard twice per year, except the twice is 6 months. Because we sell full winter product, and then we sell spring summer product, and then we sell again full winter product, and again spring summer product, and so on, and so on, and so on. That's kind of routine. And this is a pre-order driven business model, most important. Basically, we produce based on the order. We go and visit the customer, they give us an order, we go back to the fact, we consolidate all those orders, we produce 6 months after, we deliver it. That was the life before. The life after is everything I have said before, we keep doing, but now I have three different sales departments. Not only I have a B2B team, but I have also a B2C team, and I have a e-commerce team, sorry. That's it. Not only we have those two selling campaigns per year, but basically we have daily sales management in our stores and website. And our purpose is not anymore how big is the selling. Our purpose is how much did we achieve yesterday? And how much do we plan for tomorrow, not for the coming 6 months, or not for the 6 months. So this is on the same floor, you have people working with a 6 month vision and people working with a 6 hour vision. It was pre-order, now this is only daily business. We had a customer service team dealing with dealers, buyers, logistic people and everything. Now we deal with consumers. You who bought a product yesterday, I would like to know when you will get it. And you get it, it's not your size, or you don't like it, and you send it back, and we'd like to know when you get your reimbursement, and so on, and so on, and so on. So this is a totally different type of a hotline, if I may say. In the past, when we were B2B only, we had B2B selling tool. Everybody knows what selling is. So what do a rep need? You need a catalog, you need a set of samples, showrooms. Now we are mostly in showrooms, so not anymore visiting the stores with the product in the car, but they still have competitors. We have B2B reporting tools, we follow B2B KPIs, so we track the sales, we track the margin, we track the numeric distribution, so the numbers of stores, the value distribution, the sales per store, and we track our sales cost. We have a B2B planning, I already explained that, which is very routine, always the same. Every year in fall winter, we have the fall winter sales meeting. Then the rep goes on the road and they're going to be selling fall winter products for up to March. Then in spring summer, we have the spring summer sales meeting in May, and then they go on the road and so on and so on. Now, we still need to produce and to provide the B2B team with the B2B tools, but we also have to produce everything you need to run D2C. So when you have a store, you need in-store merchandising plan. And this is not that you ship the product that the guy put it on the wall as he wants, stuff like that. You need to develop Windows program because you You expect your windows to be refreshed regularly according to the story, the marketing story. And for the web, just an example of many things you have to do. Suddenly, you need to do thousands of pictures, hundreds of videos, and so on and so on and so on. Something we never did. We thought during a long time that samples were very expensive. When you need to give samples to, I mean, in a media product collection, there is 300 pieces. You need to give 300 pieces of product to all your sales reps across Europe, it costs you a fortune. You go digital and you say, yes, no more samples. Shit, all those pictures. Thousands of photos every year. Our content budget is today higher than our salesman sample budget. It costs us more money to produce pictures and video to put on our website and on our customer website, the leader and the others, than it costs us to produce samples for our reps. That's the fortune. Your reporting tools are totally different. You don't track anymore sales and margin. You track new KPI, traffic. How many people in my store yesterday? How many people on my website yesterday? You track conversion rate. 100 people comes in to buy. How do I improve that? You track average basket. You want people to put the max article in their basket. And all those new KPI, which you never tracked in the past because you had no clue and that was not your problem because you were a B2B company. You need to deal with your B2C planning, which has nothing to do with your B2B one, as I have explained. Because here we work on a weekly basis for the store, and even on a daily basis for the web. And you have to manage all those special events. Black Friday for the B2B team, nothing happened. This is our dealers making their business, and at that special time, making a special business. But Black Friday in your store and on your website, this is your problem. How do you organize it? What do you do? What is your price policy? What product do you sell? Do you which one? You keep full price and so on and so on. How do you create your traffic? If you're too aggressive, not good for the margin. If you're not enough aggressive, no traffic, and so on and so on. So totally different type of problems and issues that we have to avoid. That's some example, few example of what it means in the sales department. In the marketing communication department, the same. Before, we used to spend a lot of money to go to trade show. Wait 4 days, you go to ISPO. Maybe some of you know what ISPO is in Munich. You spend, for us, half a million, for others, much more. You shake hands, you see friends, you do no business at all. One day you wonder why you go there and you don't go there anymore, but still there is a lot of trade shows. This is how you do, this is to be the classical way of meeting his customer. You go to buying days, Intersport friends, they ask you to come during 2 weeks to meet their members and get orders. You go to special dealer events or you organize special events for dealers. And you put most of your money in B2B media and PR spendings. Because you want to be known and you want to be nice and you want to make an impact on sporting good retailers. So actually you talk to 500 dealers in France, if you're not in France, you sell your companies. This is how you spend much your money and you spend a little bit of money to do some trade marketing in the stores of your customers. So that's how you spend money in marketing and communication when you're a B2B company. I forget that. And you do some rate to measure marketing program with your key account where you define a special budget to do special communication with them. Then come B2C. And then you need to spend a lot of money on things you've never thought about. Like merchandising program, like windows, like B2C communication, local and global. But this time you need to talk to your consumers. So we're talking about consumer media, a different animal. You need to create content, as I said, and I explained, cost you a fortune. you need to develop intense social network activities, cost you money. You start to invest in CRM tools, and you start to send newsletters, and to create them, and to send them. And at the beginning, you do one every 2 weeks, and after that, one every week, you freak out. And the richest of all becomes Google, because you spend a fortune on SEO. Search, paid search. So the big winner of the e-commerce, this is Google. And then Facebook, and then but they are behind it in terms of spending, but they're coming back. And they, so, and all that, these are new expenses on top of your existing expenses. So this is going B2C from a marketing point of view. This is very inflationist for your marketing OPEX. Because you still have to take care of your B2B. If it was, I stop that, I go there, you just change how you allocate your budget. But you need to do both at the same time. This is very macro type of way of managing marketing budget at the same time. In product development, it also has impact. So the people, our colleagues, who develop our product for the coming season, ahead, today we are working on Spring 23. In the past, we used to do product where what was the most important for us was to please a buyer. Because he was the one to convince. So most of the thinking behind the product was, is it going to please Intersport? Is it going to please the buyer of GoSport or whatever? So all your pricing strategy, margin strategy, the colors that you propose are very much driven by what this guy wants. Because you are in a competitive environment, and because they are making business with Real Mirror, and if black is the best selling color, they buy black, you have to be black. And that's why sometimes in multi-brand stores, you don't have a lot of choice, because they always buy what's safe. And you do the product like that, and your product team is going into stores, is checking competition, and is discussing with buyers, what would you like to see in the collection next year? I would like a backpack like that, €9, I want to buy it at that price, and we do the product like that. It's a bit caricatural what I'm saying, but it's not far away from that. But suddenly, and you do that to beat competition. That's your main thinking. And the product managers and the merchandiser in the product team, they think like that because this is what they have to do. And you have to develop a whole bunch of jackets, as I said, 10 for the buyer to choose one. And sometimes you have to do a jacket just for that buyer, especially for him, according to exactly his briefing. Suddenly, when you become consumer-centric, as we say, that's the magic word. We are a consumer-centric company. So consumer is in the center of everything. And then suddenly you do your job because you do products which are going to match consumer expectation. Not what Intersport buyer wants, what you want and what you need. So suddenly you talk with consumers, you focus group, and you really do your job finally. Because you really do the product for the people who will buy them, not for the intermediate guy who buys it. So that's very different. I'm not sure it's easy to understand, but it's in the way of thinking of a product developer or a product manager, this is totally different when they think B2B or when they think B2C. And this has a positive impact on the product that all brands do. Because you're more precise and you're more matching consumer expectations. So that's, but the difficult part is to do both at the same time, and it's to move from one to the other. Consequences in logistics, less fun, but important to be known. When you are a B2B company, you manage containers. You receive containers from Asia or from your factory, and you deliver sometimes even containers to your customers, because we're talking about a wholesale business. So your warehouse is organized for that with places where the truck comes and drop their stuff. So lots of things like that for the truck to come to download and load products. Not every customer buys a container, but some buy several. So everything is organized and the picking and the packing and the shipping to manage wholesale business. And you measure that with typical B2B KPI linked to that. Took me 3 days to prepare that order for that customer. So, okay, that's according to our target, that's fine. But suddenly, when you do retail by yourself, you have your own stores that you need to, you want them to be always full. Each time a product is sold, you have implemented automatic reorder. So message arrives to the warehouse that they have to ship back another jacket, size M, color red. And you have to ship them to consumers. And that is very, very, very different. I don't know if you have ever been in a warehouse, but the warehouse doing wholesale and the warehouse doing B2C, these are, again, two different animals. Because here we're talking about single picking. We're talking about trying to ship in the afternoon the orders we have received before noon. And so on and so on and so on. So the KPI are not the same anymore. And what you have to achieve is very different. So you need to change your logistics. Option one, you have two logistics separate. Option two, you have everything under the same roof, but then you need to organize so that they can both channels can work together. In a big warehouse for resale, they are on fed week, they may go 1 kilometer away to find the goods, the big box, bring it back to ship to a dealer. In the B2C warehouse, the picking needs to be as fast as possible. You can have that, ask people to work 1,000 kilometers, sorry, and bring back a jacket. Not efficient. You need to rethink the volume. Production the same. When you do B2B only, you produce thousands of pieces. You purchase based on pre-order. We're talking about massive business. And everything is dictated, and your buying plan is dictated by the selling period, and so on and so on. And you need to match dealers' expected delivery date. The dealer tells you, I want my product in my store first of October. So you try to deliver first of October. When you go B2C, volumes reduce. You do not sell thousands of pieces of each product. You're talking about hundreds, sometimes less. You need more color trucks. You don't make any more any purchasing and production with forecast with pre-orders of your B2B team. You do what you can. You do some bets. You try to bet what's going to be the consumer needs next year. Try to do your merchandising plan so that it's going to look nice in your stores and so on and so on and so on. So the way of thinking and the way of buying is totally different. So the way of producing becomes different. Lucky we are, we have our two factories where we can do whatever we want because we are at home. So if we want to do 10 pieces, although it's not an efficient, we might do 10 pieces. When you are talking B2B, go in any factory in the world, nobody will do 10 pieces for you. Nobody will do nothing for you below 1,000 pieces. And your planning is not anymore when the dealers want the product in the stores. The planning is when the consumer wants the product, you need to be there. It is sunny, they want a short and a t-shirt. Shit, tomorrow it's raining. they want the coffee table. So big impact also in production, which you don't really think about at the beginning. Finance and controlling, you may wonder why it also impacts finance and controlling. I think now you better understand. When you're doing B2B only, what do you have in those departments? You have a credit management team. So basically, they are the one running after the dealers who pay late, or they're running after bad debt. So they're sending email, calling them. Sometimes they go up to a lawyer, but basically it's about being paid of your bill by your dealers. 45 days, end of the month. You manage credit insurance, especially when you sell outside of France. So when you sell in Russia and when you sell in those countries, you better be insured to be paid. You have those classical B2B reporting tools in finance, which are the GSO, how many days my customer takes to pay me. Those you manage trade working capital, your account receivable, and so on and so on. And when you do like us business outside of France, you also take care of the exchange rate. Or the dollar, maybe, but also the yen, because we said yen, and so on. This is beside every classical accountancy task and mission that you find in those departments, but related to the channel, this is that. You go B2C, I have a store, I need a cash system. I have a cash system, at the end of the day, I have cash in my pocket. What do I do with that? Do I take it home? Do I follow it? You have website, you need e-commerce payment system, not only one, several. And you need to track that, and you need to be paid. And you need to protect yourself from any action on those systems. You need specific reporting tool, because now you get money every day. And something new, you manage big CapEx. OPEX, operating expenses, CapEx, investment. When you go B2C, you start to invest a lot. You do a store. For us, it's between 200 and 300,000 euro per store. You redo your website. I don't even know how much it's going to cost us, but it's probably going to be between half a million and a million euro. So all that, of course, this is investment. So you manage CapEx and amortization and so on and so on and so on, which you don't really have to do. I mean, there are CapEx in all companies, but related to your channel, when you are in the B2B business, you don't run a lot of CapEx. You're not the owner of any stores. Any car you won't buy. You rent. There's almost no CapEx involved into B2B sales management. The CapEx involved in companies, in production, of course, in IT, of course. But related to your distribution channel, there's no CapEx. You go B2C, your life changes. And CapEx becomes very important. And that is why we cannot open 10 store per year. Change is also there. Finally, human resources. I think it is quite obvious. We used to have a pretty uniform type of sales population. People, they've been selling to the foreign goods retailers for years. This is what we asked actually. It's usually an older population. There's pretty much, there's low turnover in our industry. They are there, they're happy, they're passionate people. They do their business, well, they are successful, they stay there. And it's a small population. In France, to take care of 500 accounts and to do more than 25 million euro, 10 guys. B2C, new type of salespeople, people in stores, one leader or one store manager, one, two, three, kids on the floor. Turnover of the population, super high. Issue, human resource issue in B2C, every morning. I don't think there is a single morning where there's not someone missing. Sick, tired. I decided to change to go next door because next door it would pay me per month. And so on and so on and so on. Super high turnover. You spend your time to hire people to replace the one who left. Much younger population, especially in e-commerce. New skill needed, of course. You cannot ask a B2B sales rep to become an e-com expert. He has a very tough time to manage his Facebook account. And he's still on Facebook. And much larger population. We have 12 stores in stores plus outlet in France. This is more than 60 people. On the floor, I'm not talking about the one in headquarter, to drive them, but in stores. Because you need to be open sometimes 7 days per week. Especially in factory outlet centers, many of them. You need to be open up to 8 p.m. and so on and so on and so on. So even if maybe two or three would be needed, actually you have four staff in the store. So big impact also in human resources and impacts in IT. Usually when you do B2B, B2B ERP, so your central system which manage all your businesses. Your modern company, now you have a digital capital. And you have a B2B website for your customer to place reorder direct by themselves. That's basically the IT related to sales. You go B2C, you need your retail software, cashless system, stock management system, digital software. This is, you cannot imagine how many software there is behind a website. We have probably more than 15 partners linked to our website. The payment system, the merchandising system, the link towards the warehouse, the links towards the, and so on, and so on, and so on. So, and this is changing. You buy something, it's obsolete, you already need to buy more. Price tracking system, retargeting system, all the link with your SEA, SEO agencies, blah, blah, blah. So also huge investment in IT and a lot of new tools, which once again, 10 years ago, was not a topic for us. So that is it for the impact across all the companies. My purpose was to show you what's behind, and that when a company says I'm going to go multi-channel, nobody really has in mind what it means. So now I can tell you about that because I've been through that. But even myself, I had no clue it would be so complex. On the other hand, this is super fun. This is much more fun than the old time of B2B only every 6 months going to his potion in hands. So this is very different, but this is much more fun. It keeps you young and agile, surprise every morning, and so on and so on. I wanted, I put no numbers until now, although I'm a number guy. I wanted to give you a theoretic vision of the profitability of both brands, because this is, we've said before, I mean, this is very often a reason for brands to go B2C. This is, I'm going to make more money. So this is how it could look a B2B P&L. Numbers are wrong, but they are not so far from truth. We take the example of a product which is sold 200 euro VAT included. Basically, a product that you're going to find in the store 200 euro VAT included, we've sold it to the dealer 100. Actually, less than that. But let's say 100 to keep it simple. It cost us 50, whether we produce it by ourselves or we bought it in a factory somewhere in Asia. So our margin is 50. Our sales OPEX, so what it costs to have everything I have described for B2B, is 15 euros. So here are the reps, their salary, their car, their catalog, their assessment samples, what else they have, their travel expenses, everything related to the B2B sales force. So yes, biggest one I have described. You spend approximately 5% of your sales in marketing. So 15 minus 20, there is a mistake there. Operating OPEX are around 20. No, actually, sales OPEX are not 15, they are 20. So 20 plus 5, 25, you have approximately 25 sales and marketing OPEX in B2B. Your operating OPEX are 20, your operating contribution is 30. Then you have all the other OPEX, the one we call the allocated. So this is your finance department, your IT department, your production department, your product and development department, your the G&A department, the cost of your building, the electricity bill, and so on and so on. So this is flat. And this costs you approximately 25. Then your EBIT is 10. This is what successful companies do more than that in our industry. Less successful companies do less than that. This is what you may expect if you achieve operational excellence in B2B in our industry. And this is a target for a lot of companies and a lot of shareholders. So that is a B2B P&L theory. Look at B2C. The same product, 200 euro VAT, what you cash in when you sell it is 160. So retail price without VAT, 20% goes to the state, like France. So actually you make 160 out of that product, not anymore 100. So this is what people are dreaming of. The same product, same cost, you bought it 50. So actually your margin value is 110 versus 50. Huge difference, more than double. This is why they call that the double market. Then comes the OPEX, and here this is another story. Ah, shit, I have a store, I need to pay the rent. Until now, I was not paying any rent for my B2B business. Ah, there is a lot of people. So human resources are much higher for the same amount of money. I've told you, 10 guys to make 25 million euro on the road. On the other hand, 4 guys in one store. I can tell you there is no store making 25 million euro. Except the California Bank. Amortization. As I have said, you have a lot of capex. So those capex, you amortize them. Sorry. So your IT capex, your furniture capex in your store, and additional capex. You spend much more in marketing because we're talking about consumer marketing and we're talking especially about our friend Google. And Google, if you spend less than 15% of your sales on Google on this SEA, you're not going to make it. So just Google is in you 15. So at the end, your operating OPEX are not anymore 20. They are 65. So in other words, it is 3 times more expensive to run B2C compared to B2B. Once again, for a company like us. But I'm not far from the truth from others. So if you do everything well, your operating contribution minus allocated, you may achieve EBIT 20. What I want to say or show here is that if you do it well, you will be more profitable in B2C if you do it well. but before doing it well, and this is much more bumpy and risky. That P&L last year was not looking good when your store was closing. B2B, yes, okay, we stopped shipping for a while, but after that they reopened, we reshipped. And because they were lacking of goods, we reshipped a lot. And at the end of the year, the drop was not so big. The website went very well last year, of course, but the store was a drop. Plus, you have to take care of your staff. So once again, if you have to remember one thing is, yes, B2C is in theory more profitable. And if you do it well, if you've mastered everything I have described before in all departments, you have the right people, they have the right tools, you have the right warehouse, you're able to produce on time for consumers, you're able to make the low volume production, everything I have described. If you do all that well, then one day you will be more profitable to see the energy. But it's not going to be that easy. And this is the big trap. Many people fall in thinking that B2C is easy. At the beginning, B2C is a loss-making business model. You never make money your own. You're too afraid. So, summary. What has been for us the main challenges? The cultural switch, of course, that was a big change. For everybody who used to be there before and the newcomers. The planning conflicts, I have explained, this is still a nightmare to handle. Having today the B2B sales team who just finished to sell Spring 22 product are preparing themselves to sell Fall 22 product, while the B2C teams is preparing the Fall 21 season and the outlet are dealing with Fall 20 product. I mean, all at the same time. So you need to be pretty agile in your head because every single day, every single hour, from a meeting to another one, you're at Spring 23 at 9 o'clock because you discuss next year production. You are in Fall 22 at 10 o'clock because you discuss with your B2B team to prepare the selling campaign. You are in Fall 21 with your B2C team at 11 o'clock. And so on. And it's not only me, it's everybody in the company who works for all channels. Internal competition is a big issue because everybody competes with everybody. And especially when we lack of product or when we have a stock management issue, is a big issue. I have only one. I have 10 dealers asking for it because they order it. A year 6 months ago, but I don't have that anymore in my store, and I'm gonna be soon out of stock on the web store. To who do I give it? Everybody has a good reason to ask for it. So the one from B2C will tell you, I'm gonna make more margin with it, of course. The one from B2B will tell you, yes, but my customer took the order 6 months ago, so he deserves to get it first. And it's a very important customer, and if I don't deliver it, next year he's not going to buy from us, blah, blah, blah. And so on. And all that is regulated by machines and algorithms. And you expect that all that can be automatic, and that will follow the right funnel. But this is a big mess. Distribution strategy and channel management. When you don't have multi-channel, this is not a big issue. You sell your technical product to technical dealers, you sell your basic product and two price point product to mainstream dealers. When you have multi-channel distribution, you must decide what you sell to whom, which we have done. So today there are plenty of products that we don't sell to Amazon, or we don't sell to some of them. There are some categories of product which are reserved for our best customers. And also to avoid price competition on the web, there are products that we keep for ourselves, that we do only for us. So you may find them only in our stores or on our website. So all those studies, I mean, distribution strategy is something you have to take care of also in B2B, but becomes much more complex because everything interferes with everything. And with the web, this is pan-European. So it's something happened on the website of I don't know who in Spain has an impact on a physical dealer in Austria. Range structure and merchandising become complex. Purchasing strategy, I have explained, very difficult. Stock management allocation. So these are the main, these have been for us the main challenges. And not to forget marketing spending decision. Everybody wants more money. Every channel are very demanding in marketing, especially B2C. But your marketing budget remains X percent of your sales, and you cannot double it from a year to another because you have opened a store. So that is how it is difficult. What are the next steps for us? We want to become a true omnichannel company. As I said, I will not call us an omnichannel company today. We are multi-channel. Yes, we deal in all those old channels that exist, but still a long way to become a real one. We want to develop our stores network. We want to develop new.com across all European countries. Today we are operating new.fr.de.es, IT, and the challenge is to expand outside France. We are developing our pure player business and the marketplaces. The question is how big will be the share of that total business in 5 years from now on? What are the winners of tomorrow to make the right choice? Because there's a lot of comers, newcomers, and not all of them will succeed, so we have to make the right choice. We want to develop our hybrid business model. I said, if you were at the beginning, you remember those are franchise and marketplace business. Because we want to reach a better balance at the end between B2B and B2C. So today we are 70-30. I don't know exactly where we will end. I don't even know what is good. Is it 50-50? In our industry, the leaders, they are there. North Face, the biggest brand of the outdoor industry, is today at 50-50. And even looking into bigger companies like Nike, they are already more, they are now more B2C than B2B. But honestly, I don't know. I think it's a question of balance. We did not fix ourselves a target for that. So I don't know where it will end, but 50-50 could happen pretty fast. That is it. Thank you for your time. And now I don't know if we have time for questions.